Welcome back to Industry Voice. Our guest today is the representative of a Sweden-based pharmaceutical company developing an injection treatment for disc-related lower back pain. He will share his views on the most attention-worthy issues in pharmaceutical industry and clinical research. Please meet the co-founder and CEO of Stayble Therapeutics. Hello, Andreas. Thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you very much for being here.
So considering the world that we live in today, I cannot help asking on how pharma is coping with COVID-19. So what is happening in general? Any trends or maybe even damage?
I would say from our perspective, we've been okay. We had a process in the beginning of the year where we were working with regulatory authorities, with ethical committees, and working more remotely with the clinics. And we were very happy to see that they switched quite seamlessly into working digitally. So we had good progress in the interactions with authorities. We also had virtual investigator meetings. So I would say that we were very pleased in the initial phase with working in this environment. Of course, it's challenging. Things go a little bit slower. Then we were able to start a clinical trial. Very happy with that. But then, of course, we currently experience challenges in the predictability of conducting the trial. We have investigators getting COVID, we have centers getting closed down. So it's really going full speed ahead, full break. So it's really much more variability in how we're conducting the trial. So that is, of course, very challenging. And we see that things are going slower than we are hoping for, but still we see enthusiastic investigators and people are really wanting to be part of trials and conducting trials. So I would say that I'm generally quite positive, but of course it is challenging to conduct clinical trials during COVID.
I agree that it is all definitely very complicated, but it's very important to stay focused and exercise critical thinking. And if we move on, so Stayble Therapeutics is a Sweden-based pharmaceutical company experienced in doing trials in Russia. So in your opinion, what are the common barriers for drug development and clinical research in Russia?
I would say from our perspective, we are, as you say, a small Sweden-based company. We did a trial in Sweden and in Poland in our clinical phase one trial. And to be completely honest, we had some challenges in Poland with patient recruitment in the initial phase. And then we saw a very positive effect. We're going to be talking about that later with social media. So we were a little bit skeptical going to Russia initially, but what's really was convincing us to go there was that there, the system with quite large hospitals with a high patient flow, a possibility to really recruit patients effectively was one of the things that we were really, really focusing on when we were choosing to go to Russia. So I think patient recruitment and when we started to conduct a trial, we also see, of course, that we have a motivated investigators, which is very, very positive to see.
And what would you say are the key advantages for doing clinical research in Eastern Europe and in Russia in particular?
I would say that as well. Again, with investigators really wanting to be part, we see a much higher engagement of many of the investigators from Eastern Europe. Cost is, of course, a factor. But I think from our perspective, it's a lot about the possibility to conduct an effective treatment. And I think it's important to point out that Russia is one of the major players in clinical trials worldwide. I think I read somewhere that Russia was second after the United States in number of treated patients in clinical trials. It's really a country where a lot of people conduct trials. I think it's more about that people don't really understand the potential of doing trials in Russia.
And I think that would be very enlightening for many international pharmaceutical companies out there looking into new locations for clinical research. And now let's talk a little on how difficult it is for a pharma to enter a new country if we talk about research and marketing authorization.
Yeah, I think from a marketing authorization perspective, we don't have that much experience. We are quite an early company, and we mostly will rely on partnerships and finding different larger companies that we together would do the commercial introduction. But of course, there is there's different challenges, and we see from our perspective that working with discogenic back pain or degenerative disc disease, as we are doing, there's a lot of different type of physicians that meet these types of patients, and that differs quite a lot from different countries. So I think that's the main challenge for us, to map which will actually be the end users in which markets. And even in our small trial, where we have clinics in Russia, in the Netherlands, and Spain, we have quite different type of physicians actually being part of the trial. I think from a clinical development perspective, it's a little bit more straightforward. We've been quite happy to work with OCT in this case, where you have been helping us with all the regulatory interactions, and it's been, from our perspective, very smooth. So I wouldn't say that I see from a development perspective that we foresee too much challenges from a regulatory perspective to go into new territories. I think, of course, there are differences in European regulations compared to US regulations, and we, of course, would need to have discussions with the FDA before initiating trials in the US. But working in Europe and in Russia, we've seen very smooth process from a clinical development perspective, opening up new territories.
Thank you very much, Andreas, for such kind words. And I think you would second that selecting the right contract research organization is very crucial for the success of drug development. So could you please name key considerations you follow when selecting a CRO?
I think we did quite an extensive work when we did initial feasibility. We did quite a large request for proposal. I think our most important takeaway when we were doing the request for proposal is to be extremely detailed in what you're asking for, and require the different CROs to really specify the different parameters to be able to compare them from an objective perspective. But I think what we ended up really focusing on when we were selecting the CRO was the potential to recruit patients and the willingness to be accountable for that development, for that plan. We saw that we believe that someone that actually taking some risk in the development is actually will most probably perform a better work. I think that's one of the key aspects for us when selecting the CRO, that someone actually would like to be part in some sort of risk sharing, because then the counterpart will be committed in a much more dedicated way than if you just have like milestone payments. There needs to be something more in depth, really wanting the department to be part of this trial. But then, of course, and we are a small pharmaceutical development company, we also, of course, see different types of cost aspects in selecting a CRO. But I think accountability is one of the main criteria. And for us, we saw some challenges in patient recruitment in the phase one trial. We were able to overcome that and perform quite successful with the recruitment in the phase one. But of course, that was something that we were really pushing on when we were selecting a CRO in this process. And I think that's why we ended up working with OCT. You had a willingness to commit to the plan and also a realistic understanding about patient recruitment.
Thank you very much. And on a closing note, I wanted to ask you about social media for patient recruitment. In your opinion, does it work?
I would say it depends on the indication. It depends on the number of patients you are recruiting, and of course, which country you're working in. We did social media recruitment in Sweden in our phase one trial. And I must say, it was very effective. It was a possibility for us to find a broader aspect of patients. We were working with a clinic that performs spinal surgery, and a lot of our patients are suffering more from moderate disc degeneration, which is not a typical candidate for spinal fusion, which meant that by using social media, we were able to reach the correct patient group and to grasp them wherever they were in the different parts of the treatment regimes. So I would say from that perspective, it was very powerful. It is a little bit like you put in a certain amount of money in social media recruitment, and then somewhere in the end you find a patient. But it is a vast process. I think we had around 800,000 people seeing the ad on social media. It worked with Instagram and Facebook primarily. We had around 1,500 people that showed interest through a website that they could subscribe to get more information. We looked at 350 MRI images, and we included around 40 patients. So it works. It is a process, but it's quite a cumbersome process to be able to recruit patients. So I would say, depending on the indication, it could be extremely valuable. And we've been seeing some scenarios, especially in rare diseases, where it's really is a necessity to have social media recruitment to be able to actually find patients. But I think it could be a potential something that you add to be able to get a quicker patient recruitment. And I think one of the most positive things about social media recruitment was that the patients that we were including in the trial were very motivated. They had found the advert, they had applied for it, they got approval, and they were able to be included in the trial. So I think there is, this is of course just one trial, but I think there will be a lower dropout rate if the patients are included through social media rather than perhaps talking to their physicians.
And if we talk about Russia, we have yet to see clinical trials ads on social media here, but we never know what the future holds for us. So I think that's a wrap for today. So again, thank you very much for a great conversation, and we wish you success with your product and with further research. So thank you.
Thank you.